Okay, we're going to kick off a little bit late, and we'll see how it goes. So first of all, may I welcome everybody who has kindly attended this edition of LawAccord, which I think counting is number 14. It's fantastic, obviously, to be in the city of Aarhus, and I'm very excited about the level of connection the Danish nation has with sport. But I'm particularly happy, obviously, that you've kindly turned up this afternoon. Most people in the audience will clearly have one view or another on sport, and in particular, how sport sits within society. The truth is it has the capability to excite, to create passion, and not all human activities carry similar capabilities as sport. It's therefore precious, and probably we're all disappointed when our expectations in relation to sport aren't fully met. And there are reasons for that. I mean, I'm not talking about a situation where your favorite football team or rugby team or whatever loses an event. Hopefully, you know, that's, in a sense, is a matter of course. What I'm talking about is another situation, really, where those involved in either administrating sport or actually participating in a sport break the rules. The essential characteristic of sport, and indeed a sporting competition, is that the outcome is unpredictable. That's, of course, beyond the expectations of and the qualities, skills of the respective teams or participants. But the essential nature is that it's unpredictable. Without sport having an unpredictable outcome, then what is it? It becomes a choreographed work. It becomes all sorts of things that clearly sport is not. In today's world, there's so much at stake in the outcome of a particular event. Now, that might be the volume of money, of prize money. It may be sponsorship. It may be various other things. And of course, we should never forget national pride that is very much part of nations competing in sport and sports competitions. The issue about sport changing and it being so important is that, bizarrely, that creates an incentive to manipulate the outcome, to manipulate the predictability of that event. This year, to me at least, is almost more than I can remember, a year that's basically demonstrated the challenges that sport has in protecting the integrity of the competition, protecting that essential unpredictability of the outcome. I think it was really appropriate, therefore, when we were looking to structure this year's event, that we provided an opportunity for two bodies who are independent of sport, but nevertheless have probably had more impact and relevance than most others in addressing issues of integrity in sport, but in slightly different ways. And these bodies are, of course, the Court of Arbitration for Sport, CAS, and WADA. Each have slightly different roles, as I've indicated, in what they do. Both have very tough jobs, really tough jobs, and it's the nature of a tough job that it doesn't always go your way and sometimes you'll be criticized. But if you're brave enough to keep going and continue, you know, to do your job, then notwithstanding the criticisms that you may receive, people will see the essential value of both these institutions in terms of protecting the essential character and nature of sport. It is particularly good for me personally. I mean, I talk about CAS. It's particularly good for me personally to see so many CAS arbitrators who have attended this particular session of LawAccord. The arbitrators are really the backbone of CAS in terms of basically administrating their system, but they do so, I have to give both gratitude and thanks to
the fact that CAS has a superb general secretary who has been there for many years and continues to, in a sense, support that institution in a way that you know, deserves a lot of gratitude. And obviously he has his own administration, and in addition, we have to observe the role of ICAS and the role that ICAS has in a sense, the guiding light and providing the focus and the issues that go around that. in addition to the work of CAS and WADA, one thing I've noticed as a semi-practitioner now in this area is really the involvement of criminal law enforcement agencies in the whole arena of sport. And that creates immense challenges, some of which are continuing to unfold. Arbitration as a model is primarily a contract between two parties. You agree the terms under which you arbitrate, and in most circumstances, the result is private. You've agreed the system, you've agreed the place. The criminal law doesn't work quite like that. And we've seen criminal law activity, certainly in the US justice system, with various indictments in relation to FIFA matters. And these issues and the interplay between the criminal law now and, in a sense, the sports industry, I find is a fascinating one, and one that any practitioner in this space is going to increasingly get involved in. And I suppose the essential question is, just because you're a sports administrator or you're playing a sporting event, does that mean that you've got some form of immunity against aspects of criminal behavior and criminal law? I mean, logic says no, but establishing where these boundaries move is I think, a very interesting concept. I certainly also don't think that we should forget the role sometimes played by national courts. It's not always the case, but I certainly wish to take my hat off, for example, to a situation that's evolved in India over the last 6 or 7 years. The BCCI is arguably, well, it is the largest cricket body in the world, and is extremely powerful. The Supreme Court has intervened in the administration of the BCCI, and the BCCI is currently, its affairs are currently being conducted by a committee of administration, basically under the auspices of the Supreme Court. And that's, in a sense, pending various governance reports and steps that the court itself has decided through its committee, the Loaded Committee, are incredibly important to maintain the reputation and integrity of that institution. So national courts certainly in some jurisdictions, you know, have a tremendous role to play in protecting what I began to talk about, which is the unpredictability of the sports performance. So perhaps on a slightly lighter note, I'm trying to unfold for you what's going to happen for the rest of the day. The other session that we're going to look at a little bit later, which is a sort of a panel discussion session, is the growth of esports. I mean, LawAccord has looked at the underlying commercial models that support a variety of these new commercial models in sport. And we can't ignore the fact that esport, if you look at the demographics themselves, you look at now the prize money that is on offer in professional sports, and more importantly, you look at how it connects with youth, with a new community. We can't ignore what's happening. So the purpose of that session, hopefully, is to help people understand whether esports is just the mirage in the desert that may soon disappear, or whether it's something that is and becomes a permanent feature of the sports landscape and all that flows with that. So we've got a fascinating discussion that will basically take us through, I hope, those issues. I should also mention, in relation to sports, esports, we can't, I have to say I was a little bit surprised about the depth that the Danes have in terms of developing e-games and how much actually as a nation they're involved in it. They were one of the very early founding members of one of the governing bodies. And also currently the current winner, the current title holder of the FIFA Interactive World Cup is indeed a Dane. So the Danish nation does have an immensely strong tradition in this particular area, and hopefully will gain from the benefit of their knowledge. So look, before starting the program, just a few sort of housekeeping issues. We encourage questions from the floor. I mean, these sessions don't work without the questions, so we're very keen to receive questions. We prefer to take them at the end of the sessions, if that's possible. If the speakers indicate and stop and say, please, you know, I'd like to discuss, I'd like views on this point, take the lead from the speakers. So that otherwise, at the end of the session, hopefully we've left room for questions. The other sort of thing to note is that I understand that we are graced with the presence of some members of the media this afternoon. You're most welcome. There is not a formal press conference going to be given in relation to this event, but hopefully there'll be an opportunity at the end of the session, if you have any specific questions that you've not dealt with during the session itself, to talk to any specific delegates. Generally, that's it. I tend, in relation to speakers, in a sense, the details of the speakers are available in the program. You can read the program. I don't intend to read that information out. It is the custom speakers may sort of introduce themselves. But generally, the shape of the day we have at the moment is we're going to start off with the Court of Arbitration for Sport sessions and updates. Reiner will take us through a particular aspect that he's got a great deal of knowledge of, on how CAS's jurisdiction was challenged. We'll move to the interactive session on eSports. We'll then, depends a little bit on other timing issues, but then we'd hope to cover off the wider session, and also there'll be some further issues that involve the new CAS jurisdiction for its new role in effect in relation sort of the wider list and code. So are there any questions anybody's got about the shape of the day or how we intend to conduct it or anything else? It's an invitation to say something. It's very important that if you've got, you know, you've got a viewpoint, please, when it comes to question time, you know, please raise it, because this is a great opportunity with such a distinguished gathering to get that information. And if there are no further comments, questions, points of clarification, Matthieu, I'm going to move to you.
You should switch your mobile phones off, of course. And mine's just ringing.
Okay, ladies and gentlemen, dear colleagues, we have actually a lot of CAS members here. It's a pleasure for me to be here in Aarhus. It's a beautiful and authentic city. I think it's the smallest host city of LawAccord ever, but it's probably the biggest conference room that we had in the history. We decided a few years ago with Steve Townley that we would have a kind of general presentation of the activity performed by CAS in the last year or the year preceding each conference. The goal is to have a tradition where we can expose and have a flashback on the important events and also have a discussion later. Perhaps we keep it for the second part of the afternoon when we have the discussion on the anti-doping division. We have more time then to discuss. I don't know if I pass the charts with this. Shall I use this device to
press the green button?
the green button. Yes, it works. So the program for today is to cover in a few seconds, just the Pechstein case, because for us it's important to mention it. It was in June last year. Then we have a further discussion on the story of the Russian athletes at CAS, then the Olympic Games in Rio, quick note on the future games in Pyeongchang, and the recent CAS case law in the last 12 months. I take 1 minute, because we have Dr. Martin speaking in a moment about the Pechstein case, just to say what the consequences are for ICAS and for CAS, because this is something Rainer will probably not say. So the story about the Pechstein case will be for later. I'm just telling you that probably, as perhaps some of you expected, that the fellow tribunal in Germany would upheld the decisions rendered by the Munich courts. Some journalists, also some sports experts, sports law experts, have already had already said that it would be the end of the Court of Arbitration for Sport, and that we should think of a future tribunal or a future structure to handle sports law matters. There were some negative aspects about this case, and suddenly we had this decision rendered in June last year, accepting the appeal by the International Skating Union, which means for us that CAS would remain as it is now. I will not touch the decision itself, but there were not so many negative aspects in the end for us, because most of the CAS decisions about the structure, organization, independence, funding, membership was not really contested by the German tribunal. But nevertheless, ICAS wanted to take some measures to make sure that the confidence in this institution would increase still, especially among the athletes' community. It started already before this procedure. Between 2010 and 2014, the ICAS membership has changed. There are less sports officials. There are more people coming from outside the sports movement, like arbitrators, judges, or people representing authorities, but outside the sports movement. So this is a first step. And the second step, which will be also implemented by the ICAS, is to keep the mandatory list of CAS arbitrators, but to facilitate the turnover. It means that probably more arbitrators will be changed after each cycle of 4 years. The reason for that is also that, because we note some arbitrators are generally appointed by the same parties regularly, which gave them a kind of label. And this is something we cannot do anything against. It's true that if a federation chooses the same arbitrator for many cases, this arbitrator starts to have a label on his back or her back. And this is something which is not good for the perception. And it's not only for the federation side, but also for the athlete side, where we can see that a population of arbitrators are generally selected for certain cases. So that's it for Pechstein. I will just mention that we still wait for two other decisions from the German Constitutional Court and from the European Court of Human Rights. We don't know when these decisions will be handed down. I move to Russia and the big saga that we had before the Olympic Games, starting with the athletics, the International Athletics Federation imposing a new rule for the Russian athletes. It was in May or June that the rules have been enforced, and the 17th of June there was a decision by the IAAF to suspend or to maintain the suspension of the Russian Athletic Federation and to impose a kind of global ban of all Russian athletes because they were trained and they were in Russia during a certain time before the selection started. It means that 67 athletes who were supposed to be eligible to go to Rio were not eligible anymore because of this new regulation. It's led to an appeal to CAS, even two appeals, like a class action because the 67 athletes came represented in one appeal, and the appeal was dismissed by CAS, the CAS confirming the decision of the IAAF to suspend or to exclude these athletes from selection for the Olympic Games. The only athlete, Russian athlete, who was eligible was Daria Klishina because she was in USA since 2012. Then it's the IOC level, the 24th of July, the IOC Executive Board decided to implement special rules for the selection of Russian athletes before the Games. You probably know the story and you remember the special conditions, the famous points 2 and 3. Point 2 was that the athlete had to prove they could undergo doping test outside Russia, they could escape the so-called state-sponsored doping system. And the last point, the point number 3, was that the athletes should not have been sanctioned for doping in the past, even if the sanction has been already served. That's the point number 3. And the IAAF then had to review all, each federation had to review their own selection of Russian athletes before the Rio Games. The week before the opening ceremony in Rio, we had this special procedure involving CAS arbitrators, but not as in the function of CAS arbitrators. They were appointed by the International Olympic Committee to serve as experts in order to evaluate the position or the status of each Russian athlete, whether they were able to participate in the Games or not, whether they fulfilled the criteria set up by the International Olympic Committee. So these experts were mandated by the IOC, and the IOC took the decision in the end to accept these athletes or not. There was a tripartite commission of the IOC dealing with this question. And it was just the time for the start of the Olympic Games in Rio. We had, for the first time, I said that last year, two divisions, the classic ad hoc division, plus also the anti-doping division, which is a new structure. The two divisions were separated, even if they were located in Rio, both divisions, but with a different structure, different presidents, and different arbitrators. I start first by the ad hoc division. We had 28 cases, a new record, but we should maybe a little bit be careful with this figure because 16 of these cases were involving Russian athletes, so the sequel of the previous discussions about selection of Russian athletes. So in the end, we had 12 non-Russian cases, which is a little less than the record, which is 15 cases registered in Sydney for the ad hoc division. 26 awards have been delivered, and 4 applications have been upheld or partially upheld. If we take the Russian cases, I don't want to go through all of them, we can have a kind of general summary of what was decided, what came out from these decisions. The famous points number 2 and number 3, point number 2 of the IOC guidelines was confirmed as valid by the CAS panels, but point number 3 was considered as being not valid, not a valid requirement to prevent the participation of these athletes. This is the so-called Osaka rule. If an athlete has been already suspended, it's not a reason to suspend him or to exclude him a second time after he or she has served the suspension. So this was clearly set in the decisions. The appeals of Yulia Efimova and of two kayakers or canoeists have been partially upheld for that reason. These athletes still had to go through the, I would say, adjudication process, and point number 2 was still to be fulfilled, but at least they had no obligation to fulfill point number 3. We had also the Weightlifting Federation suspending the Russian Weightlifting Federation. There was an appeal also in Rio for that, which was dismissed. And the last important case involving a Russian athlete was the case of Daria Klishina, because the IAAF decided to revoke the selection of this athlete just 2 days before she started to compete. for the reason that she may have been involved in some training sessions in Russia. Nevertheless, she was based in, despite the fact that she was based in the United States, but the CAS panel decided to overturn the IAAF decision and to allow Klishina to participate in the Olympic Games. The non-Russian awards, they are quite classic, if I can say so, because there was no spectacular case. They were concerning, two cases were concerning former doping cases which could not be decided on time before the game started. So there was a decision rendered by the ad hoc division, and it's the fourth application granted. It was an application filed by WADA against an Indian wrestler, I think, Mr. Yadav. We call it also the Curry case because this athlete complained that his food was tampered by the rival. Both were fighting for the selection for the games, but these explanations did not convince the panel, and the WADA application was upheld, and doping case was confirmed. There was a case about nationality issue, which was a bit unfortunate. It was a so-called Kenyan athlete who was entered and was not admitted to enter in the Olympic Village because he didn't have a passport or a identity card with him. He was not able to prove his citizenship, and nobody helped him, even not the NOC. It was a bit strange situation because this person did not have any assistance in Rio, and it was probably an administrative problem which was coming from Kenya itself, or the administration in Kenya, which caused this situation. And we had a few so-called field of play cases. We always have these cases. They are quite emotional, quite special. If I think of the case of the French swimmer, Aurélie Muller, who was disqualified at the 10-kilometer open water swimming. There was a collision at the end of the race with another athlete, another swimmer, and the French swimmer was disqualified because of this incident for improper behavior. And it's a matter for the, I would say, the judge on the field, on the water. It's more a technical question for which the Federation is responsible. And for these reasons, we do not touch such decisions. But it was quite a special situation. And we have also the case of qualification and selection for the games, including one athlete from South Sudan. South Sudan, it was the first time that this NOC was accepted or invited at the games. And in athletics, no athlete from this country could be able to make the selection times. So they had the permission to select two athletes, whatever the performance, in athletics, one male, one female. But unfortunately, the NOC of South Sudan selected two males athletes, and it was not possible, so one of these male athletes had to be kicked out from the selection, and it was also a kind of emotional case. The anti-doping division, we will talk about this a little later in more details, but this division was created for the first time here in Rio. It's a first instance procedure. It means that there's a possible appeal either before the ad hoc division or before the normal CAS. This division was able to issue provisional suspensions or final suspensions, at least exclusion from the games. There were 13 applications. I think 8 were filed during the Rio Games, and 5 came after the end of the games. 11 of these applications have been upheld. One case is still pending because the International Federation, I think it's the IAAF, had also initiated a procedure, so we have suspended our procedure pending the resolution of the other case. And one application was dismissed. It's not because there was a doping case which was not a doping case, it's because an applicant chose the wrong division. It was a Russian athlete who was in fact challenging an exclusion from the game, so it was clearly a case for the ad hoc division, but this athlete and the lawyer decided to go before the anti-doping division, We suggested to this lawyer maybe to file another application before the ad hoc division, but this person said no. He wanted a decision from the anti-doping division of CAS, so he had his decision, which was no jurisdiction, sorry, and it was the end of his case. The global objectives for the ADD, this is also it's an intermediary statement for later. The goal is really to expand this division in order to simplify all these anti-doping procedures, to have an independent authority dealing with all these cases, especially for international level athletes. The goal is to reduce the number of authorities, of instances, also to save time and money and energy, and to harmonize all these decisions so that depending on the sport, depending on the substance, depending on the violation, at least there is a common line of jurisprudence. I go to the recent CAS case law just to start with our database, because sometimes people don't know that we have an archive with a search engine which has been improved since the beginning. It is quite easy now to use it. It's accessible on the CAS website. You can enter different data depending on what you want. If you want to have all the awards of a certain arbitrator or all the awards rendered in 2014, or if you are looking for just a keyword like a substance in a doping case, this is something you can select, and you have a result which is also comprehensive with a list of cases with a PDF document that you can open to read the decision itself and the details or the data concerning every case which are summarized in on the page. So that's for the database. If I come back to my list of recent cases, or the cases rendered in the last 12 months. I should say a word about the role of CAS now working as a first instance already, so without talking about the anti-doping division, but since the Russian Athletic Federation is currently suspended by the IAAF, there is a rule in the IAAF regulations that if a member federation is suspended, it cannot adjudicate any doping cases, so CAS takes this mission over and will replace the federation which is banned. So it means that all cases which should have been handled by the Russian Athletics Federation is now delegated to CAS as a first instance body. What we try to do in order to simplify the system is to propose, and the IAAF also does this, is to propose to the parties to have one single instance which is kind of direct appeal to the CAS, so that CAS can render a decision as a sole instance without a further appeal. But it's up to the athlete to decide. Some athletes are happy with that. Some prefers to go through two instances. And we have a situation, for example, with Maria Savinova, who was found guilty of an anti-doping rule violation due to blood doping with the values appearing on the biological passport. So this athlete was suspended for 4 years and disqualified for the last 2 or 3 years between, I think, 2012 and 2014. This athlete has filed now a new appeal, a fresh appeal before the CAS appeals division. So it means that we have a second panel, different from the first one, dealing with this case again. We had approximately 20-25 of these cases involving athletes and coaches from Russia, including some famous coaches like Dr. Portugalov, who was found guilty of permanent doping violations due to his involvement in the so-called Stepanova case, Yulia Stepanova, the whistleblower, who revealed the story about doping in Russia, especially in athletics, and involved some coaches, including this Dr. Portugalov. He was banned. It's a life ban for him. Then the FIFA election cases. It's a long story also. We all know the cases of Monsieur Blatter and Platini, the famous payment of 2 million 7 years after the time it was necessary to pay, so 7 years late. It was paid in a way which was not really official. Although the payment was in the accounts, it was not something which was based on any contract, except the word of Monsieur Blatter that nobody can establish. So for that reason, the absence of a contractual basis meant that there was no validity for such payment, and therefore both were suspended. Sepp Blatter suspended for 6 years. The sanction was decided by FIFA and confirmed by CAS, and Platini was suspended for 6 years by FIFA and 4 years finally by CAS. We still have some of these cases pending, including the one concerning the former Secretary General, Jérôme Valque, and another one involving Mr. May Nichols. He was a member of the FIFA Council. So these cases are pending. I think another one from Mr. Chung Mung-yoon from Korea should be filed soon. I heard that, or I read that in the newspapers. The case of Maria Sharapova and the International Tennis Federation, it's a famous case, although the case is not that difficult on a legal point of view. But the story shows also that CAS panels can use their sensitivity to determine the proper sanction against an athlete. Sharapova used the substance meldonium after the deadline of the 31st December 2015. And she admitted to use that substance a few days after the deadline. She recognized the fault, and the question was whether the sanction should be 2 years or less. The CAS panel found that it was a case of a non-significant fault, but still the athlete bore some responsibility for the negligence because she was just listening to her entourage without really asking the good questions, and therefore she was suspended for 15 months. The suspension is, I think, almost over. Serbia and UEFA, it's regarding the admission of Kosovo as member of UEFA. Serbia challenged the decision of the UEFA Congress to accept the FA of Kosovo as a new member. The reason is more formal than something else. It's the fact that, according to the UEFA regulations, only countries recognized by the United Nations can be admitted as member of UEFA. The problem is that the United Nations do not recognize countries. In fact, it's the members of the United Nations which recognize countries, and therefore there was quite this difficulty to interpret such a UEFA rule. But the panel considered that the spirit of the rules was clear. It must be a recognition by the international community, or at least the majority of it, and also the fact that the UEFA Congress accepted at a large majority the presence of Kosovo as a new member, which satisfied the panel to dismiss the appeal filed by the Serbian FA. Belarus Canoe Federation versus the International Canoeing Federation. This is a case which is quite unfortunate also, because we had this situation. I mean, the appeal was filed just before the start of the Olympic Games. The men's team of the Belarus Canoe Federation was excluded from the games by the International Federation after some medications or strange packages were found in trash bins of the hotel where they were for a training camp before the games. And therefore, the entire group was banned from the games. There was an appeal. There was a request for provisional measures to let these athletes participate in the games, which was dismissed by CAS because many elements were missing in this request. But in the end, the CAS panel found that there was no reason to ban all these athletes because the evidence was not strong enough, it was not clear enough, except for maybe one athlete. The others were not really suspected, could not be suspected of doping, just on the reason that some medications were found in the trash bins outside the hotel of the delegation. So the appeal was upheld and the athletes were free to compete again, but in fact the games were already far behind us. I have 2-3 minutes to terminate with the case of FC Seraing versus FIFA. It's a case concerning third-party ownership. Decision simply says that the FIFA regulations banning TPO is now validated by CAS. It's an important decision, which is in French. Seringue had a partnership with Doyen Investment, which is an investment company, to buy and to transfer players. But since 2015, these TPO systems and transactions are no longer possible and no longer authorized, and therefore Seringue was sanctioned. They were sanctioned by FIFA. Impossibility for them to recruit new players for four transfer windows. It was reduced by CAS to three transfer windows, but still I heard that maybe an appeal could go before the Swiss Federal Tribunal. It's an important question. We still have some important cases pending, especially in cross-country, where we have five Russian athletes filing appeals following a decision of the International Skiing Federation based on the famous so-called McLaren report. It's the first time we have that type of cases based on the findings of the McLaren report, so we will have to see how it goes in the next months. And also the case of Therese Johaug from Norway, 13-month suspension due to the use of lip balm, I think, and it was containing a substance, stanozolol, a steroid. The International Skiing Federation wanted to have the opinion of CAS, so filed an appeal to request that the suspension be increased, and we will see what it gives in the next months. The next challenges, and I will finish with this, of course, it's to manage the growth of CAS. I will show you the next chart, the increase of the number of cases. Also to increase the number of arbitrators in some region of the world, because sports is everywhere, but we don't have the same exposure everywhere. We encourage also the athletes' commissions to propose new CAS members coming from the athletes' world. We hear sometimes criticism about the fact that there are not so many people knowing the athletes' problems and the athletes' issues among the CAS group, but it's a possibility for them also to propose people with legal training being interested to become CAS members. The goal is to prepare also the anti-doping division for Pyeongchang and also to prepare the move of the CAS to its new location, probably in 2019, in the Palais de Beaulieu. It's in the center of Lausanne, so we stay in Lausanne, but it should be a bigger place, probably the triple or even more than that of surface available for the CAS premises, but this is for the future. This is the chart where you can see the evolution of the number of cases. So 609 cases registered last year. It's a special year because we had all these Russian cases. We had the Olympic Games. Normally, it's a tradition we have more cases in the summer, the year of the Summer Games. We'll see in 2017, but probably there will be a slight increase, but not so big as we had last year. The appeals before the Swiss Federal Tribunal are also quite steady. There is no increase. Rather, I would say the number of cases upheld by the Federal Tribunal are decreasing. 166 appeals since the creation of CAS. Only 10 have been successful or partially successful, mostly on jurisdiction. It's a proportion of 6% of all appeals filed and 0.35% if we take all the awards granted by CAS since its creation. So it's still acceptable. I think the average is 7.5% at the Swiss Federal Tribunal. So it's okay. We also do mediations. 10 mediations last year is a new record also. Mediations sometimes are a bit forgotten, but it's useful in certain cases, especially when we have commercial cases involving parties dealing with contractual relations and they want to continue their relations. So mediation is something that we should try sometimes better before starting the arbitration procedure. So we propose generally when we see that a matter could be good for mediation, we try to propose that to the parties. They are free to accept or not. And if they don't want to try, then of course we go to arbitration. But we had, out of the 10 cases registered last year, we had 6 successful mediations. So it shows that the system works, and it's also faster and less expensive. And I finish this. Thank you very much for your attention.